Welcome to my Zabbix 4.0 talk. This talk will give you an overview of the upcoming features in 4.0, which is not released yet. First, I will go over the features in Zabbix 3.0. Why Zabbix 3.0? Because 3.0 is an LTS version, and you have some other versions between the two LTS versions, but probably LTS is what you want to use in production. So I give a quick overview in the slides first of what is in 3.0, and then what we can expect in 4.0. So some of the features that you will see in the slides, you'll maybe have already if you are running 3.2 or 3.4, but that is because those versions are not LTS, so I just skip them and put all the major versions that are coming in 4.0 in my slides. So who am I? My name is Patrick Aterhoeven. I'm an open source consultant for the company Open Future. I'm also a certified Zabbix trainer. If you want to follow me on Twitter, my nickname is Trikke76. I also have a GitHub account. And I also published a book, a Zabbix cookbook, a few years ago. It was published by Pact. It's a bit outdated at the moment, but if you're still interested, you can find it there. So, an overview of 3.0 LTS, and where are we today with Zabbix 4.0. At the moment, there are a few versions available. There is version 2.2, which is an LTS version, and there is version 3.0, which is the current LTS version. Why do I say current? Because LTS 2.2 version is almost finished. It will end soon, so it's best to go for 3.0, and of course, if 4.0 is released, it's best to go to 4.0. If you need, of course, new features which are not available in 3.0, then you can go to 3.2 or 3.4, but 3.2 is end of life. Why is it end of life? Because Zabbix has a certain release policy. They release an LTS version, and then between the two LTS versions, they release minor versions. Normally, they do a release policy of like 6 months, but it's not always exactly 6 months. They just see where they are with the features, and then when they think they are finished, they just release the version. So when you have 3.0, after more or less 6 months, you have 3.2, and then 6 months later, you have 3.4, and they end the support for 3.2 like 1 month after 3.4 is released. So if you have a minor version, you need to update a lot to get support from Zabbix, because now they don't do any fixes anymore for 3.2. So that's why I say if you go in production, just stick with the LTS versions, then at least you have more support for those versions. So why choose LTS? For the 5 years of critical support and security patches and 3 years of full support. What is full support? So besides the critical and the security patches, you also get minor improvements. So sometimes Zabbix does some minor improvements in the LTS versions, and that is what you get in those 3 years as an extra. So the first 3 years you get all the support you need, and then at least 5 years you have all the security patches if something happens security-wise. So the 2.2 version has limited support ending in August 2019, so you have like 1 year to migrate. And Zabbix 3.0 has support ending in February 2019, so you still have some time to migrate as well. The limited support is ending February 2021, so if you want to stick with the bug fixes, you still have a long way that you can use Zabbix 3.0. So, just to give you an overview of what is Zabbix, what it can do with the version that we have now, 3.0. This, by the way, for all the Zabbix versions, it's GPL version 2 compliant. So the source code is freely available. Also, there is no hidden version, like when you do an installation of Zabbix, there are no like hidden features where you have to pay extra to get some support or to get, for example, extra features. So everything is included in the source code. So if you look at Zabbix, when we install Zabbix, we have our agents. We have, for example, Zabbix agents, but we can also have like simple checks. Simple checks are just checks that we do from the Zabbix server itself. We have a backend. The backend is written in the C language to get the most performant system. We have a database. The database is an SQL database for 3.0. There is a frontend, and the frontend is written in PHP, so it's quite customizable if you want. Zabbix also makes use of an API, and we can communicate, for example, with our ticketing system or mobile applications with the API. Then we also have a proxy, and I have put the proxy a bit away from the rest, because the proxy is something that you install, for example, on another site to get, for example, a connection with another site or another country. Or for example, if you have lines that are not really reliable, you can install proxies because the proxy is in fact a small Zabbix server without a front end. It has a database, so you can stack all the data first in the database and then move all the data from the proxy to the Zabbix server. This is automatic, but if the line cuts, there is a certain cache that you can keep on the Zabbix proxy. It goes from 1 hour to 1 week, so it's quite large, it's customizable. So what is added in 3.0? So we have it already. They added strong encryption. So for example, between the Zabbix server and the proxy and agent, Zabbix server and agent, we have now encryption between all the Zabbix server and the components. One thing is missing here, it's the Java gateway. There is at the moment no encryption between Zabbix server and the Java gateway. Also the database, the connection between Zabbix server and database at this moment is not encrypted. So it's something that you have to keep in mind. So there is strong encryption between all the Zabbix components. There is also multiple authentication methods. We have OpenLLAP Active Directory. You can also use Apache if you like, but nobody using it, I think. I think everybody, oh, you do, you're the first one. Okay, nice. So you can at least connect with other things instead of making users by yourself. There is a flexible user permission schema. Flexible, people who know Zabbix know that it can be more flexible than what it is now at the moment. It's not really that very flexible, but at least it gives you more than enough power to, for example, create normal users, super users, and normal admin users, etc. The Zabbix code is open for security audits. Like I told you, it's version 2 from the GPL, so you can download the source code, you can make modifications, you can, if you have bug reports, report them to Zabbix. You can also do feature requests. So for example, if you think that you can create a new feature by yourself in C or in PHP, you can just upload that patch in Zabbix, and then Zabbix will add it to Zabbix in the new version if they like your patch and if it is conform to their standards. So you can also do feature requests if you don't know how to code and if you like a new feature, and then normally the most top-voted features will be implemented by Zabbix. Another way to get new features in Zabbix is by sponsoring Zabbix. At this moment, 80% of Zabbix server is sponsored by companies. So more or less of all the features that we see today are sponsored by companies. So this is how Zabbix works at the moment. We have Zabbix agents, so we don't really have to find another component to install on our servers. We have Zabbix certified agents. They are available for most of the platforms, for Solaris, for example, HP Unix, BSD, OpenBSD, FreeBSD, Linux, AX, or macOS, and even Windows, so you're quite flexible with the agent. A Zabbix agent can work on different platforms and collect metrics from any device or application on performance and availability. So once you have installed your agent, you can write your own scripts, put them on the Zabbix agent, and the Zabbix agent can launch your own scripts, or you can use the built-in functions from the Zabbix agent. So there are certain built-in functions that Zabbix has provided for you, so you can use those, and then they will collect metrics from those agents and send them to the Zabbix server. When I say send it to the Zabbix server, it's not completely correct, because we can configure an agent to, for example, support active or passive checks. So we can, for example, configure our agent to be active, and then it will send data to the Zabbix server, or it can be passive, and then the Zabbix server will poll the agents to retrieve data from the agents. So if you need active or passive communication, you can choose which one you prefer, or you can mix them both. So you can even use passive and active mixed together. Of course, active is better, because then you offload the Zabbix server, so it will be the agent that is doing all the work. We are able to extend them via custom parameters, like I told you, and something that was added in 3.0 as well is modules. So we can create our own C modules and add them in the Zabbix agent or in the Zabbix server, and then we can extend our agent instead of using Bash scripts or Python scripts, etc. Of course, if you write them in a, if you want to write a module, you have to use the C language, so you need to be able to write C code. But of course, it is more performant because you're using the agent as a native solution. So what if an agent is not an option? It happens sometimes that you cannot install an agent. Then Zabbix has other solutions built in. We can use SNMP, we can use IPMI, and we can use, for example, the SSA agent. Telnet is also an option, but I think it's out of the question, I mean, so I have not added it. So agentless monitoring is an option. We can also do, for example, a monitoring of Java applications and databases. The Zabbix server can connect, for example, to a database, and it can launch a query on the database and then retrieve the value and add it in the Zabbix server. There is also low-level discovery for databases added in 3.0, so that is also an option. Java is possible by making use of the Java gateway. The custom scripts of metrics, we can, for example, create custom scripts and add them in the Zabbix server, just like we did on the agent, and then we can launch, for example, a script from the Zabbix server and do something on another server that we have. Then we also have aggregated and calculated checks. Calculated checks are, for example, if you have already some items in Zabbix and you would like to create a new item, for example, if you like to calculate the volume of the inked in your printers, you could do this by, for example, pulling some SNMP items and then use two or more items to calculate a new item. The aggregated function is something like, imagine that you have a group of servers, a group of MySQL servers, and you like to know the average CPU load of all those servers. Then you can create some kind of group check. So you just create a check that is based on all the checks on the individual servers and calculate for the whole group. That is what an aggregated check is in Zabbix. Then we have VMware monitoring. Zabbix is also able to connect to a VMware machine and then retrieve all the information from VMware and add it into Zabbix. So we can do direct monitoring of VMware as well. Web monitoring is also an option. You can, for example, monitor a web page. You can see how long it takes to go, for example, from the Zabbix server to the web page, how long it takes to log in with the user, because Zabbix can log in with the user in the page. And you can also do a post and see how long it takes. So you can do some nice monitoring of websites. It's custom checks if you like to do something like this. Web monitoring as it is today in 3.0 is quite limiting. For example, JavaScript is not supported. So a lot of websites are using JavaScript today. So if JavaScript is not supported, you're stuck with Zabbix at that moment. And you have to write something by yourself. So what can we use as source of information? Like I told you, we can use the Zabbix agent. This is the Zabbix server polling. There is the agent in active mode. This is being processed by the Zabbix server, so it's the agent sending data to the Zabbix server. There is a simple check. The simple check is always executed by the Zabbix server, so the Zabbix server connecting to the agent or to the host or whatever you use. There is also SNMP. All versions of SNMP are supported, so 1, 2, and 3 are all supported. There is also a Zabbix trapper. Zabbix Trapper is in combination with Zabbix Sender. Zabbix Sender is a small tool from Zabbix that is more or less mimicking an agent. You can use your own scripts to create something and then send the value from those scripts with Zabbix Sender to the Zabbix server. You're not even limited to like one value. You can create, for example, a text file with a list of values, timestamps, and then just send it in batch to the Zabbix server. Yes.
Not to the agent.
No. Or to the proxy, yeah. Log file monitoring and VMware monitoring. So we can, for example, monitor log files. We can do some regular expression checks on log files and then see if it returns a value. Then there are certain health checks. In Zabbix, we have now an option to check, for example, the health of the Zabbix server or, for example, the Zabbix proxies. So there are built-in caches, and we can monitor those caches to see if they are big enough or not too big or something like that. So it's normally self-monitoring in Zabbix. Aggregated, we have average, mean, max for host groups. So for example, if you have a host group, you can calculate a minimum, a maximum, or an average value for that group. External checks, I told you we can create our own scripts. So with external checks, you just launch your script and with the needed parameters. And then SSA authentication, telnet authentication, the calculated value, and then ODBC. Like I told you, you can do an SQL query on a database and then retrieve the values from that database. We also have triggers in Zabbix, because if you have the data in your database, then of course you need to build some triggers because you want to get notifications. So we make use of logical expressions. We have certain predefined trigger levels. It goes from not classified to information, warning, average, high, and disaster. Those cannot be changed at the moment. Those are predefined in Zabbix. So it can be a limitation. So we have like six levels at the moment. An expression looks like this. It just tells you, for example, to go and see at one server or one template, and then it will add the key at the end. This is the key, and here you add your template or your host name or host group, for example. And then you will see, for example, here it will monitor the CPU load as an average over 180 seconds, and it will see if it is higher than 2. So in this case, our trigger will go into an alarm state. We have a visible representation with different colors. So for all these levels, we have different colors. There is also audio in global alarms. We have like global alarms in Zabbix. A user can configure its own alarms in the front end, and then you can add sounds and pop-ups, etc. User media. Normally, we have for every user a media that we have to define, and we can be flexible with the user medias in Zabbix. There are some predefined medias, like for example Jabber, Mail, SMS, but we can extend it with our own scripts. If you have, for example, Slack, you can send messages to Slack or something else. Limiting action by conditions, again, trigger severities. Zabbix works with triggers. Zabbix works with users and groups, and we need to create actions and conditions in Zabbix to get notifications. So in our actions, we will define, for example, that we want to send an alarm to a certain group if, for example, this host or that host has a severity level higher than a certain level that we have in Zabbix. We can do this, for example, for groups. We can do this for servers individually. We can do it for many things. So it's quite flexible, but it takes, of course, a lot of configuration work. Something else that we have in 3.0 is trigger hysteresis. At the moment, we can do, for example, like here, a certain check. This is a bit of a special item. It's a trigger value, so it will check its own state. So if you write it like this, for example, without hysteresis, you will get flapping. You will get, for example, your server room that goes up and down. You will get notifications like, OK, not OK, OK, not OK. So to avoid this, we make use of hysteresis in Zabbix. So for example, here we have the trigger value equals 0, and the temperature last, so it's the latest value from the temperature, is higher than 20. So our trigger is in an OK state, but the temperature is higher than 20, so we want to get an alarm. We want to get a notification. Or the trigger is in a problem state, but the server temperature is still higher than 15. So it has to stay in the problem state in that case. So this is a bit of a complex workaround to not get flapping in Zabbix 3.0. But for this, you can use, for example, like here in the server room, but you can also use it, for example, for your hard drive. You can check, for example, if the hard drive has, for example, 10% space and, for example, 20% space, and then see if it goes, for example, below the 10%, you will get a notification. But if it stays between 10 and 20%, you will not get an OK state because you don't have enough space yet. So you can use it for many things. Then we have the relative trigger. The relative trigger, we can compare, for example, a result with a result in the past. So you have, for example, a result today, and you have a result, for example, like 1 week ago, and you can compare those two values and then see, for example, if it is more than double of what you had in the past. Why is this useful? Imagine, for example, that you have a new software developed and you want to see if the CPU load from that software is not exaggerating after the new version is installed, and you can create, for example, something like this, where you say, okay, I want to check my CPU load from today with like 1 week ago or 1 day ago, and then Zabbix will tell you, okay, CPU load is much higher with this new software version than it was before. Of course, it's quite usable for other things as well. Then we also have templates in Zabbix. Templates are, for example, a set of elements that you put together, like your items, your triggers, the graphs, the low-level discovery rules. You all put them in like one template, and then you can apply those templates to, for example, another template, so that you, for example, group all your templates together, or you can apply them, for example, on your servers. Like here, for example, you have the template Linux, Postfix, and Bacala. You all put them together in the mail server template, and you link the mail server template to all your different mail servers. Then you don't have to create your items individually per host. So it makes things more easy. Also, we have macros in Zabbix, and you can put the macros, for example, on your Zabbix server, but you can also put them in the mail, for example, in the template, and you can put them in the administration panel. So you can still be flexible, even you are stuck with like one template. If there is an exception on one host, you can override it with, for example, a macro on the host. So, to be short, what we have seen is Zabbix collects data on like every level. It does it on hardware, it does it on the OS. Here we use agents. Here we use agents, other we use APMI. We have network that we can use, for example, the agent, or we can use something else like scripts. We have the virtual layer, VMware. We have the incoming data and the logs, for example, log file monitoring and scripts. We have the middleware, Tomcat, Apache, etc. We can use, for example, the GMX gateway. And then business applications, you can use anything with scripting to go monitoring your own applications. So we can do it on every level with Zabbix. If you like to monitor, for example, like 200,000 devices, it's a bit annoying to add all the devices manually by hand in Zabbix. So we have solutions for that too in 3.0. There is network discovery. Zabbix will scan the network, and based on certain rules that you put in your condition and action, it will add devices or remove devices automatically from Zabbix. There is the auto-registration. This is based on the active agent. The active agent has the IP address of the Zabbix server, so first time it will send a heartbeat, and Zabbix server will pick up this heartbeat, and it will automatically register the Zabbix agent in the Zabbix server. And then with your action conditions, you can tell Zabbix to add the Zabbix agent. Based on certain configuration parameters that we have in the agent, we can automatically link it with the correct templates. We can, for example, do a check on SNMP and then say, OK, it's an SNMP device. And then Zabbix knows, OK, I have to add the SNMP template. And then there is also low-level discovery. With the correct templates, you can, for example, discover your switches or discover, for example, the hard drives in your machine, the logical volumes, and Zabbix will automatically create network interfaces, logical volumes, and it will map it automatically with the correct things. Then data collection and web monitoring. We can do web monitoring. So, for example, you can ask Zabbix what the response code is from your website, and you can monitor, for example, the speed from your website. It will look, for example, how long it takes to download a web page from your website. There are some web scenarios. So we can build scenarios in 3.0. This was not possible before. We can also do, for example, a login and a logout. But I told you, JavaScript is not supported, so most of the websites today are a bit difficult to do. There's also support for HTTP and HTTPS. And there is a check for predefined strings. For example, you can look on a web page for a certain word or a certain number, and then Zabbix will return you that the check is OK because he has found the word on the web page. Reuse of content extracted from one page on another page. So we can use, for example, one page. We can extract content from that page. And then we can use that, for example, to do a check in another page. So with macros, we can be flexible. Of course, everything that we have collected needs to be stored in a database. And at this moment, Zabbix 3.0 only supports MySQL, PostgreSQL, Oracle, DB2, and SQLite. SQLite is possible, but it's not recommended for the Zabbix server. You will get problems with locking. But SQLite, for example, works perfectly for proxies. At this moment, I think every proxy I've installed is with SQLite. The advantage of this is that you can put it on embedded devices. If your device, for example, is locked up, you can just pull it out. And if you install, for example, the SQLite on a temporary file system, it will just recreate the database automatically. So if your database goes corrupt, you just reboot the device and you're good to go with a new database. So it's very easy to do, and you can use it on small devices. There is an unlimited amount of historical data that we can store in our SQLite or any other database. We can tell Zabbix proxy to keep the data for a certain period of time into, for example, the proxies. Why is this useful? For example, you want to gather data, and then, for example, you want to run some queries, or you have an application that wants to retrieve information from the proxies, then you can do it by storing the data, for example, like 1 hour or 2 hours in the database. Also, if you have, for example, devices that are not connected all the time during the day, you could, for example, just store all the data in the proxy, and then when the connection comes back, the proxies will send it to the Zabbix server. One of the companies that does this is a Belgian company that has a monitoring system in buses in South Africa. They have built their own devices, and they are monitoring during the trip from the bus, everything from the bus, see if the doors are open, closed, etc., see if the ticketing system is working, and then when the bus arrives at the station, the proxy will send all the data to the terminal. So it's quite easy. Manage data. The items that we have created, we can, for example, put history per item in Zabbix. So you can tell Zabbix to keep, for example, per item, like 1 day of history, 2 weeks of history, 1 year of history. So you can do this per item individually, or you can override it. There is built-in data reduction. We have trends for the average historical data. So for example, if you say, okay, I want to have route data for 1 week, then you can put the data, the route data, in the trends database, like, for example, 1 year. The trends database will calculate the mean, max, average, and the count per hour, and then put it in the database. So this is much smaller than your route data, of course, and then you can keep more data in your database. Zabbix also has a housekeeper that is running in the background. So if you, for example, delete something in Zabbix, it's not deleted directly in the database, but it will be cleaned up afterwards by housekeeper. Also, housekeeper makes sure that, for example, history goes to trends, and that trends goes to dev0 after. You don't need the trends anymore. So we have long-term storage, and we have per-item retention periods. So if you put everything together, we want to get notifications, and notifications, like I told you, are based on the action conditions. So we have like SMS, email, Jabber, the chat messages, command execution. Command execution, for example, I told you we can create our own scripts, for example, with Slack, but you can also tell Zabbix if something happens, connect to this server and reboot, for example, the server, or restart, for example, Apache, and stuff like that, so you can create your own fixes with Zabbix. There is also something new, it's an event acknowledge function in 3.0. You can now, for example, if there is a problem, press the ACK button, and then you can write, okay, I am busy with this problem, or look at this ticket number, or someone is busy with this, but the problem is still there, and it will be fixed in, for example, 1 day. And then people can get those messages if they like. This is how the dashboard looks at the moment in 3.0. So you have a dashboard with all your groups, all your hosts, some data here from the Zabbix server with how many templates, how many users, how many problems, etc. And you can create links to, for example, graphs. It's not the most appealing dashboard, but they have fixed it. Yeah, it's possible. Yeah, but 3.0 is not really that nice. Yeah, but it's much more polished in 3.2 and 3.4 than what we have now. It's possible that I took an older... Okay, my mistake. We have graphs in Zabbix. There are simple graphs. So normally when you retrieve data, you have to put it in graphs if you want. But Zabbix has something like simple graphs. So for every value that is going into Zabbix database, Zabbix will create a graph. So you can just go to the latest data and then tell you, okay, I want to see a graph for this data, and Zabbix will do it for you. So you don't have to create the graphs by yourself. If you want to go to something more complex like this, then you have to create the graphs, of course, by yourself. But you can put them in templates, and then it will be with the template. There are also maps in Zabbix. We have different available elements that we can put in the maps. Sorry. We can also drag and drop, easy edit. There is reference data that we can use by using macros. We can also nest maps, for example, go from one map to another map. And they have, of course, support for UTF-8. Those are the screens. So you can put all graphs together in screens, but you can also put, for example, websites or maps or anything else. This is just like one example. So this is what we already have. So what's coming in 4.0? So what are the changes? Because that's what you want to know today. First of all, there is pre-processing from the data. Now when you get data from Zabbix, it will arrive directly in Zabbix and you cannot do anything with it. With 4.0, it's possible to do pre-processing. So you can manipulate the data that you have retrieved from one of your items and then use that data as an item in Zabbix. So for example, there is a write trim, a left trim. So you can, for example, cut the latest value from the right, the left or the right from the value. There is also JSON. So in the older version, you had to create your own scripts to pre-process JSON. Now you can just say, I want to create an item web URL, point it to a JSON web page, and then retrieve a certain part from the JSON with Zabbix. So you can go and get a value from, for example, the message bus MQTT, I think that you mentioned yesterday, or someone else, or RabbitMQ or something else. They also have normally a JSON page. So you could, for example, go and to that JSON page and then collect values from it. They also have regular expressions. So from everything that you get as data, you can launch a regular expression and then use... by the way, they use a Perl regular expression in 4.0. Before, it was a bit of a mix. It was mostly the POSIX, but now they have changed everything to the Perl regular expression in Zabbix. So we can use this as well. So we have XML pod, we have JSON pod. So XML is being processed as well. So it's quite nice. Another thing in the pre-processing that is changed. Before it was only possible to retrieve like one value and you had to create like several items for several values. Now with one script, you can just say, give me a list of values and it will be sent to the Zabbix server. And then you can create dependent items. So you just create like one item that has all the values and then you just create a dependent item where you say, okay, I want to filter out, for example, this value here or this value there, and then you just create items. So you don't have to create a script that sends all the items one by one. You just create a script that sends everything to Zabbix and then you do it by, for example, regular expressions as a dependent item. So when you create your master item, it will retrieve all the values and then you create your dependent item that is linked to, for example, the master item. Here you create, it's not really visible, I think. And then you have to create a regular expression that filters out, for example, the server uptime, and then you get your item server uptime from the list of all the items. There is also a problem page now. Before it was not really clear what problem happened. Now they have a problem page that is time-based. So as you can see, it gives you an overview of the time here, and it goes from the latest value to the oldest, or you can switch it. It's configurable like you want. So you can just say, okay, I want to have a filter for a host group or a certain host, and then it will give you an overview of all the problems on that host or host group. So you can see what happened and how many times it happened. So it gives you a better overview. So the problem page is also new. I think it's already available in 3.2, by the way. Problems. I told you we have an ACK button. But something that is not available at this moment is, for example, to close when you do an acknowledgement of a certain problem. This was problematic in older versions. For example, if you had log monitoring, you could say, okay, I acknowledge this problem, but it would not close the problem. So if you were looking, for example, in a log file for the word error, it would show you, okay, there is an error, there is a problem, but it would never go back in an okay state because you had to create a filter to put it back in an okay state. So you had to check the log file for the word okay or something else. So now you can, for example, with the ACK button, close your problem. So if you do, for example, log monitoring, for example, for Bacula, for errors or something, you could close it and then it will be closed till the next check and then it will go back in a problem state if there is still a problem. And the messages can also be sent. Tags is also something that is new in Zabbix. It's already partially implemented, but will be more extended in 4.0. We can create, for example, two or trigger certain tags. The new way in Zabbix will be completely tag-based. So the idea is to put tags on all the items and triggers that you have, and also the users will have the option to get tags. This way, it's, for example, possible to do some filtering on data center or a problem, etc. And then we can also get notification when certain tags are in a problem state. Then you can do some correlations between certain services, which is not possible now with Zabbix. So, for example, if we create tax production and tax critical, then you can make correlations between the production and the critical part, and then send, for example, notifications only for critical in a production environment. You could also create, for example, with different data centers tags, and then you can, for example, say, okay, I want to get the criticals, but also the criticals that have an impact in, for example, data center in New York. And then you can get your notifications for New York if they are critical. Also, with the event correlation, it's possible, for example, to create rules when new problems appear. For example, if there is a new problem that you didn't know before, then you can create, for example, a problem that has a correlation with a certain rule in Zabbix that tells, hey, there is a new problem, I want to get notifications from this as well. So, for example, for the existing problems with the tags and the correlation rules, we can close existing problems. If you say, okay, I have an issue and I want to close it automatically because I know that the issue will be resolved in time, then you can, for example, tell Zabbix to close it automatically. Macros are also customized. We now have regular expressions on macros. So, for example, if you retrieve a value and you put that value in a macro, you can use that macro again in another item and use regular expressions on that macro. So you can, for example, get a certain part from the macro instead of using the whole macro. In the case we have now, you had to create a new macro or you had to define something in your scripts. So now you can filter parts out of existing macros. We have seen the trigger hysteresis before. It's a bit changed. It was quite difficult in the old way here. In the new way, we just define a problem state, and we also have a recovery expression state where we say how it will be recovered. So it's much more easier than it was before. You just say now the problem is, for example, if CPU load is higher than a certain value, and it is okay if it is lower than a certain value. So you don't have to create the trigger value with the internal checks anymore. It's much more easier. There are also custom dashboards at the moment. So with the dashboard that we have now, we are stuck with the dashboard that is provided by Zabbix. Now every user has the option to create his own dashboard. So every user can create the dashboard that he wants. He can add values, he can add maps, he can add graphs, he can add links, he can add, for example, the problem page in it. So he can create a dashboard like he wants, and you can create different dashboards, for example, for the service center or for the monitors on your wall. Also, permissions are, of course, respected, so someone who has not a permission to see something cannot see it in the dashboards as well. And you can share dashboards, by the way. You can create dashboards for a group and then share it with the whole group. The map navigation tree is also new. Before we had maps, but now we have also, now we also have here a tree. So you can create, for example, multiple maps and link them together, and then you have a navigation tree to go easily from map to map. Templates for network devices. Before, Zabbix out of the box was quite difficult to configure because nothing was delivered with it. Now we have templates for many network devices. Almost every big network vendor has templates in Zabbix with a new release. So normally just going through the list of templates, linking it with your device, and it should work. There is also remote command support through proxies. Before, it was not possible to create scripts and then launch those scripts from the Zabbix server. We had to copy them to the Zabbix proxy and then launch them from the proxy. Also, front-end scripts were not possible to launch from the front-end to the agents. Now, the proxies can relay the commands automatically. So if you create something, you can choose to launch it from the Zabbix server, the agent, or the proxy. So you only have to place your scripts in one place. Parallel processing of alerts in the Zabbix that we have now, processing alerts is like a single process. So if you had like a lot of users and you had to send like SMSs, emails, etc., it would take sometimes a certain delay. With the new version, you can say how many services you like to run in the background, and then it can process, for example, SMS and alerts by email at the same time. So it goes faster. Other improvements, notification on problem acknowledgement. When you have the ACK button, you fill in information. But now with the new version, you can send those information, for example, to the group of users. Or you can send it also to everybody who was involved. So for example, if I am an administrator and I'm not involved by getting messages for this group, but I have ACK the problem, then I will also get the problem in my email box, the message, what I have done. And everybody else who is involved, who has, before, for example, acted before, will get the message that the problem in this case was fixed by someone, or that it is not fixed, or with a ticket number, etc. You can also use the macros to create your own customized messages for the ACK. Also new is for GMX low-level discovery. We had low-level discovery already, for example, network cards, hard drives, etc. But now there is also GMX low-level discovery, so you can discover beans, or you can discover attributes from beans with Zabbix. So you just tell Zabbix to look at a certain point in the GMX, and then it will discover everything that it has from beans in that. So you can, for example, discover all the garbage collectors automatically. So with Java, sometimes the name from the Zabbix, from the garbage collector will change. So with the low-level discovery, you don't have to create macros anymore. You just tell the garbage collector detector in Zabbix to detect all the garbage collectors, and it will create and delete them automatically if they come or if they go away. Configurable endpoints. This was not possible before either. Now when you have multiple Java applications, sometimes they have different endpoints. So before it was hard-coded, now you can create your own endpoints. So if you have applications on different endpoints, you can just specify the endpoint in Zabbix. One of the other things that is in the new version is support for Elasticsearch. It was a question already by many people to support NoSQL databases. So now they have Elasticsearch as backend, as database for the historical data. So all historical data can go to Elasticsearch database. Checking item values immediately was also an option that has been requested for many years. So before it was not possible to do a check now. You always had to wait till everything was processed, and then it could sometimes take a minute or two, three. Now you have the check now button to go and check what the item value is. Yeah, this is for historical data. Okay. So it's the housekeeper will move it to the Elasticsearch, and then you can. For calculated data, it should work as well because you just retrieve it, and aggregated, it should work as well as either. What it will not do is, for example, if in Zabbix 3.0 you can do, for example, trend prediction. Trend prediction is always from the latest data, the raw values. It will never go to the historical data. So. It will not happen. No. It will check the check, but it will retrieve the latest value that has been retrieved before. So if it has not worked before, it will not work. It will not initiate a communication with the agent. Then there is a new item, an HTTP item. Yeah, it's not really visible in the slide, but basically what it does is you can send a GET request, or you can do a POST request on a web page, and you can retrieve values. And then, like, it's not really visible here, but for example, you can choose XML or JSON, and then you can say here what you want to retrieve, and it will look if it's being retrieved, yes or no, and then you can do some irregular expression, etc., again on that JSON. So it's a nice new feature. It will support also HTTP and HTTPS. And as a bonus, you get the Zabbix sender, where you can do some traps. So if you don't want to monitor a web page, you can just send a Zabbix server a link, for example, or just a JSON or XML. Multiple emails in one user media. Multiple email addresses can be used. Before, it was only possible to specify one email address per user. Now, one user can have multiple email addresses, so you can send it to different mailboxes over different times in the week, for example, in one mailbox, and in the weekend in the other mailbox. Real-time export of events, values, and trends. There is now an export option. So the real-time export of trigger events, item values, are in delimited JSON. So if you like to use it, for example, in some other application, you can just retrieve the values in JSON format and use it in another application. So all the values that you get from Zabbix can be used somewhere else. The tagged base permissions, I told you before, it's completely rewritten. So now we have the user groups where we have the tags, so we can have the tags linked with what we have seen in the previous slides, where you can just put tags on, for example, the triggers. So this all works together with the new system. Compression is also new. There is now compression between the server and the proxy. So there was already encryption, and now we can add compression as well. So if you have, for example, bad lines, it makes sense to compress the data to get as less as possible through the lines. So it works very well. Also, the communication protocols have been changed to lower the number of data that goes through the lines, so it has been optimized as well. Okay. And then there are the new dashboards. We have the new dashboards already, but there will also be a kiosk mode for the screens, because in the kiosk mode, it's not really visible here, but here you still have like a small thing from the menu from Zabbix. In the kiosk mode, you will only see what you have selected, like for example, only the graphs, etc. So you have more space to put things on your screens. So it's a nice new feature. Of course, those are the most important improvements, but there are, of course, many more improvements. And like I told you, there is like version 3, version 4, but you have two versions between. Some of the features that you have seen are already implemented in 3.2 and 3.4. Some of them are still going to come in 4. But if you go, for example, to those pages, you can see, for example, what are the new features in every version. You can have a look by yourself, because there are many more improvements on macro level, on low level, discovery level, really tiny improvements, but that make life more easy. Also, support Zabbix.com. You can go there and see what there has been created for Zabbix, like feature requests. And you can also see what is in the planning for 4.0. So if you go there, you can have a nice overview of what is being planned for 4.0 in the upcoming release. So now, the big question, the release date. At this moment, we are at version 4.0 alpha 5. Zabbix has promised to deliver in May, but of course it will be later, because we are still in alpha. I suppose they will do some release candidates, and Zabbix, knowing they will do release candidate 1, release candidate 2, all in a very short period, and then just release it. So I think more it will be like end of May, maybe June, and then we can have a 4.0. Of course, that is my guess. I have asked Alexei, but he don't want to fix a date, as usual. So it can be that, for example, a new sponsor turns up, wants to have a new big feature, and that it just moves a bit for a few months. So I can't guarantee, but my guess is May or June to get the 4.0. So this was my presentation. I don't know if you have any questions, if something was not really clear, or if you want to know more, just ask. Okay, it's the last slide, by the way. Right, we'll see. But I don't know if they publish the slides, else I can always give you a copy of the slides if you want, so.
Can you propose it out in the official Zabbix CLI tool?
What do you mean with the new CLI tool? Oh yeah, you mean for a CLI tool, really for a Zabbix server to...
There
no.
is one which is maintained by yeah. University in Berlin, if I remember,
no.
in
no.
Zabbix CLI is really great, but it's still community-based.
It's community-based, no. I don't think that Zabbix will do anything like this. Unless some sponsor turns up who really wants that feature, but I don't think, because you have the API and they are really pushing to use the API. And but yeah, Zabbix CLI is indeed nice. But nothing from Zabbix.
From what time would you recommend upgrading to 4.0?
Usually when I do it in our company, when it is released, like the day after, I just install Zabbix. But in production, I always wait like one, mostly two or three release versions. Mostly because the first one is probably like 1 week after, because some major bug turned up. And then like a few weeks later, there are some small patches, and then mostly the second or the third version is okay to go with. Yeah, probably. No one? Okay, thank you.